Morning. Good afternoon, everybody. So, welcome to the third session about the data portal. I will share my screen. Now that you know everything you need to know to insert a Genesis station into the EPOS network, and how to upload the station metadata to the M3G, thanks to the very good presentation of Karine, we will present you the EPOS Genesis Data Gateway. First, presenting what is the EPOS Genesis Data Gateway, and then we will show you with a demo recorded in a video how to explore and download data and metadata with the two different clients we have to do that. So first, the EPOS Genesis Data Gateway is a portal where you, as a user, will be able to request for all the Genesis data and metadata for all the Genesis station integrated into the EPOS network. So we and Karine already present you this scheme with the provider here at the bottom. They will put their data and they will populate some local nodes, and there they will be transferred to the Genesis Data Gateway of some metadata file information. And then as a user, if you do a request here, you will get all what you need, I hope. So this system is hosted at the Côte d'Azur Observatory and maintained by CNRS in France. So we will go briefly to three questions. What is it? How does it work? And what is its current status? So what is it? So the EPOS Genesis distribution system that you can find here on this figure that you will see several times in the presentation was developed in the framework of the EPOS IP project. It was designed to provide access to data for more than 2,000 stations from data centers across Europe. So with this in mind, the principle of the system is quite simple. It's a European portal here that integrates the data and metadata from independent local nodes that you can see here. But this portal is also linked to the station metadata submission center that Karine just presented you and to the European product portal that will be presented tomorrow. How does it work? So now I think perhaps you understand very well with the first two presentations. It works with the transfer of metadata. So first, you upload your station metadata at the submission center, and the submission center will transfer to the data to the central European portal this station metadata. Then the portal will transfer the same station metadata to the local nodes they belong to, that means to the node that hosts the station in question. So they transfer the station metadata to the one node, other station metadata to another node, etc. Then the file metadata, they are built at the local node, and they are transferred from the local node to the central European portal if their quality check metadata are validated, as Karine explained to you. Else, they will stay, the file metadata will stay at the node until the solution to make the validation okay is solved. The quality check metadata, they are also built at the local node, but they will stay at the local node. They are not transferred. Note also that the Rhinex file, they stay in their data center, which can be different from the GLASS node. So what does that mean? It means that you can request all the data and metadata through the data gateway, even the QC metadata that will be requested from the central European portal to the node they belong to. But a user can also request local data and metadata to a specific local node. It means that over the whole system, there is a unique metadata for a data file. It's what ensures that the unicity of this metadata. So now, where we are. So here you can see the current status of the node network as seen by the data gateway. So you have still the data gateway in the center of the figure. And here you have the nodes that already integrate the EPOS node network. There are 11 local nodes. They are hosted in 9 countries. You can see all the small flag. And you note that we are open to integrate new nodes as necessary. I will just have a brief view of 3 of these local nodes. So the Pan-European node here that is hosted in Portugal, which is a node where a provider will be able to upload his Linux file if he doesn't want to install a local node and manage a local node, or if he cannot deal with a national node to deal with his Linux data. Another node is the one related to Aref, and that is hosted in Belgium. And the third node I want to talk about is a node hosted in France, IAPGP, which is a node which is related with the Volcano's activities in the framework of EPOS. So we imagine that new nodes will appear like this one, related to Volcano activities or related to Near Fault Observatory activities, for the ones that would like to distribute the Genesis data acquired for this kind of activities. So the question that everybody probably asks himself, what is currently available in this system? So you have in red the number of stations that you can discover and download the metadata, and in green, the number of files that you can discover and download. So at the data gateway, there is 1,145 stations, the same number as Karin already told you at the M3G. And you can also have access to 2.6 million of files, of Linux files from the data gateway. You can also see how this station and file distribute at the moment in the different local nodes. And as you can see, there is a difference in the population of the node. So we have few nodes that are almost complete or complete with the historical data, and that are almost operational or operational on a day-to-day basis. These few nodes are the RobRef1, the French one, the INGV1 in Italy, and the C4G1 in Portugal. For the other nodes, they are in the way to be populated, and so new files will be coming hopefully soon. If we look in a map view, here is a map, the same map as the one as Karin showed you, with all the stations that are integrated in the EPOS framework. On this one with the red circle, you have all the stations that have at least one file. So it corresponds to more than 800 stations. And on this one, it represents all the stations that have at least 3 years of data, which is about 600 of stations. And usually if they have more than 3 years of data, they have their archive complete. So that means like 8, 10, or even more years of data. So now we will go to the second and third part of the presentation with a video that will show you a demo of how to use the EPOS Genesis web and command line client to get the Genesis data and metadata. So you will be able to do it with a graphical way or to do it with programmation with the command line client. We will first show you the web client. And I will go through these 3 points: the overview of the web client, how to discover and download the metadata, and how to discover and download the data. Here is the most important address of this presentation, which is the address of the portal. And so let's go to this address and to the demo. I stop the share screen. So Jean-Luc, if you can put the video. Thanks.
As you can see, the interface can be divided in 4 areas: the header and the footer, the control zone, the map zone, and the table zone. On top and completely bottom, you will find information relative to the GNSS data gateway and links to the other services of EpochGNSS. First, the help with the guided tour of the interface, a video demonstrating how to use the interface and the documentation of the interface. Here you see the bottom linking the other EpochGNSS services, the product portal that will be presented tomorrow, the M3G that Karen just presented, and the integrated core service portal that will be shown in the next presentation. On the bottom, you can find other information like the list of nodes here and a contact address for the data gateway. In the second zone, the control zone here, you will find the button that allows to search and download station metadata and the button to search and download the file metadata and data. The clear button allows to reset the world interface. Finally, the advanced search button displays a panel of choice. When complex requests are necessary, we will see it later. In the center here, you will find the third zone, the map zone. It is the area of geographical interaction and selection. The map shows the station location. It is possible to drag the map, zoom in and out with Control plus Scroll, and to select the station. It is possible to select an area, either with a circle, a rectangle, or a polygon. And on the left, it's also possible to use coordinate to determine an area of selection, either rectangular on the top or circular at the bottom. The station network can be selected there. At the moment, there are 3 types of networks. International one, like the one of EPOS, but all the data are EPOS data. So you can see here we put the IGS or EPN international network with red and orange circles. So we use hot color for international network. You can see that you can choose local network with inner colors that are different. And also the third kind is a virtual network, for example, as for volcanology or near fault observatory network with bluish circle coloring. So we use cold color for this virtual network. And finally, here is the fourth zone, which is the table zone, where you can see the main station metadata. The metadata can be selected, filtered, or sorted in each of the columns. And we will do an example. For example, we will look for stations that were installed before January 2000. You see that it found 82 stations. Then you can sort them, for example, by date of installation. But also, if you are interested to know from which network they belong to, you can sort them by network. Or if you are interested for only stations that are located in a specific country, you can sort by country. For example, we can use France. Now we can clear everything and try another example. We can look at station in a specific country. This time we can use Italy. and all what appear is station located in Italy. You can also look for a specific network. Let's use EPN. And you can see that it appears only the station belonging to this network. So all the columns can be used to filter or sort, but you can also select rows. For example, I will select 3 rows here. And you see that the circle associated to the station in the map zone will be highlighted. And actually, I don't know if you notice at each example, but all the selection and filtering we've just did from the table panel, they are quite fast because all the metadata are already preloaded. So there is no need to send the request to the database. And secondly, they are dynamic in the sense that the effect is directly visible on the map and in the table. Then if you want, you can also refine with further criteria using the advanced search panel. In that case, the request will be a little longer as it needs to send a request to the database at the DGW. The criteria of the advanced search are diverse. So you can see that you can look for other type of station metadata, the receiver type, the antenna type, the radome type, and the satellite system. But you can also define some criteria for file metadata. For example, to see which data exists for your date range of interest here, but also specify the minimum percentage of data available or the minimum number of years you want the station to have some data. You can specify the type of RENEX file you would like or the status of the file, which reflects the quality and a quality indicator with respect to the RENEX header or what is expected in the file. There is the pop-up that explains you the 1, 2, or 3 status. Finally, you can also select criteria about the observation in the file and the quality check summary. Selecting criteria in the QC file info box will be much longer as this metadata are stored locally and not at the DGW. So for example, let's try to search for stations that have more than 3 years of data. So you enter the number here and then click on metadata search and you have a new window that open and that give you the results. I will come back to it later. So let's go back to the main page and clear any selection. So now I will show you how to discover and download the metadata with still the web client. So for that purpose, I will use a use case. For example, one wants to study the Leteil 2019 earthquake. So first, let's find all stations with different criteria. First criteria would be, for example, looking for station located in a radius of 100 kilometers around the epicenter of the earthquake. So we enter the longitude and latitude in the box and the radius of 100 kilometer. You can see the station appearing on the map. Then we want station that were installed before 2019. So let's do it in the table zone. And with data between the 1st of November 2019 and the 30th of November 2019. So we do it in the advanced search box. Now we have all our criteria that are set. And we click on the metadata search button to get the metadata. It will search the database for all the station metadata corresponding to the selected criteria. The new window appears, displaying the station metadata resulting of the query. This window shows also several areas. So let's describe them. In the control zone area, you can see three buttons. Add in the history to save this query in your history for later purpose. The download button to download the metadata in GeoDaisy ML, JSON or IJS site log format, which could be the purpose of your search. Or the export button, which allows to export the query either directly to the API or for using the command line client. Then there is a list of stations and their metadata in a table. You can especially see the instrumentation and the percentage of data availability that is now accessible. Moreover, as you can see, there is only 8 stations compared to the 12 in the previous interface. 4 stations having no data in November 2019. Then the map of the station restricted to the selected station. If you select a station in either the table or the map, you can see its time series retrieved from the product portal here. On the bottom, the data availability is displayed for the stations from their installation to the current date, as well as the percentage of data availability over the life of the station. You can also zoom in if you want. If you click on a specific station, for example, AIGL, it opens a new window and you can display even more information about the station, which is sorted in a tab. So there is the station and monument information. The instrumentation has a list, but also has a session view. There is a new line every time there is a change in the main instrument, which means antenna, receiver, or radome. The green shows what changed. The contact tab lists the contact of the station. Data availability allows to explore the availability of the data as a heat map, where the greener is the month, the more data there is. When a month is clicked, the list of day with data for the month appear. So it's possible to download the Rhinex farm from there. You can select one or several days and click download. So let's try it. But it's not the main interface to do that, because it doesn't allow you to select a lot of files. Finally, the QC tab displays some QC for the date chosen, but but avoid to choose too many days because it would be long to download. Okay, now let's go to the third part. So discovering and downloading data with still the web clients. So we will continue with the same use case and go back to the main window of the web client here, where we selected our criteria previously. So the dedicated way to download Rhinex file from the web client is to select file search. So it opens a new window, and there is a new tab that shows the file metadata for the 8 station, like the file name, the file type, the date the data were required, etc. From there, it is possible to download either JSON with all the file metadata, a script that uses wget to download the data, a list of file URL, and finally an option to download directly the data selected. You can also export the query to be used with a command line client, for example. For massive or automated downloads of the data and metadata, it's better to use the command line that Jean-Luc will now present to you, and you will see it will be much faster.
While the web client is perfect for exploring visually the metadata and downloading some data, for massively or regularly downloading data and metadata, the command line client is more adapted. As you can see, when the archive is uncompressed, four files are available: the changelog, the configuration file, the software itself, and a README. Let's have a look at the available parameters for the software. First, we have H to show the help message and exit, U to select the last server to query, and CF to select a config file. Then we have the station metadata parameters, such as M for the marker, RS, CS, PS that allow to define respectively a rectangular, circular, and polygonal area of selection. The next six parameters allow to define the latitude, longitude, and elevation of the selection. And the next four define the installation and removal date of the stations. NW allows for selecting network, and INW to remove network from the selections. Some more parameters for the station metadata are here. I will skip them. Here we have the file metadata parameters. DDS and DDE for defining a starting and ending date for the data. DA for defining the percentage of data availability required. And there is more parameters for the file metadata. We can then choose an output with O that allow to select the format of the output. There is JSON, GeoDBML, and Sitelog for the station metadata, and a list for the file metadata. The RENEX can also be downloaded by setting this parameter to download. Finally, download DIRS allow to select a specific path to save the data. As for the web client, two main modes of use are present: querying for the station metadata with the station parameter, and querying for the file metadata with the files parameter. To give a short example on how to pass the parameters, this command shows station metadata in JSON for the station ACT00FRA. Note that several markers can be queried at the same time, here, AIGLE and ACT. Now, let's have a look to how can we download the metadata. They can be downloaded as JSON just by redirecting the output of the command to a file, like this example. They can be downloaded as GeoDBML by using the parameter O GeoDBML. They can also be downloaded as AGL Sitelog by giving the parameter O with the option Sitelog. Let's have a look now to how can we download data. Files can be downloaded with O parameter, give it the value download. Let's go back to the showcase of the web client. Finding station metadata and data for the Lotte 2019 earthquake. Let's find all the stations located in a radius of 100 kilometers around the epicenter of the earthquake at a latitude of 44.5 degrees and a longitude of 4.67 degrees. We want all the stations installed before 2019 that have data between the 1st of November and the 30th of November. So the parameter stations allows to search for station metadata. The parameter CS allows to select all the stations belonging to a circle centered at the earthquake epicenter with a radius of 100 kilometers. The parameter IDMAX allows to select all the stations installed before 2019. The parameters DDS and DDE allow to select all the stations having data in November 2019. The parameter OSiteLog allows to download the station corresponding to these parameters. As you see, we have 8 site logs. Now, if we want to download the Renex file corresponding to these parameters, it is sufficient to replace the parameter stations with file and the output from SiteLog to download. Adding the parameter download.dir Renex allows to store the file in the directory Renex. Let's have a look. This concludes the demonstration of the web and command line client. Let's finish with some useful links. The N3G, the Data Gateway, the Product Portal, the ICS. And finally, to contact the Data Gateway, write to this address gnss-dgw@oka.eu. Thank you for your attention.
Okay. Mathilde. Very nice. There was already one question by Andrea. She will be unmuted. Yeah. Hello, Andrea. No. Okay, if she's not there, I can ask it myself. So there, you showed that there are 800 stations from the 1145 that provide data to APOS. So there's only 800 stations?
Yeah, at the moment, only 800 stations show some files. Because all the local nodes do not have populated completely the node. It takes time because, as it was explained earlier, there is all the process to validate the file data and to cross-check with the station metadata, etc. So once a node is installed and station metadata are uploaded at M3G, it takes time to manager of node to complete all the process. So it means that there is now more than 1,000 stations for which provider would like to provide the data to APOS, but they are in the way to do it.
Okay, thank you very much, Mathilde.
Okay. One note, please. We can unmute you, but we are giving permission to the people to unmute. But if I understood clearly, you should after unmute yourself. So you put you need to unmute to be able to speak. There is another. A question by Jordi Palas. Can So can you unmute Jordi, please? Okay.
I have a question. I am from from Barcelona, and all of our files are in Linux 3, and we are trying to update the files in the platform in Glass, but all is correct, but the statistics or quality check don't work. I think it's the platform is for Linux 2.
No, Linux 3 should work. And it works because we have Linux 3 in the system.
So yes, the Anubis. The Anubis works, but in the class the statistics it don't works.
Okay. Ah, you mean the visualizations? Yes, it's for the visualization. There was a bug that has been corrected recently, and now it's working even with Linux 3.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So there was also a question by Lucy Rowland. You can ask it. Lucy, are you there?
Hello.
Yes, we hear you.
Yeah. Hello. Yes, I have a question about the number of files or the volume of downloadable data, Linux data. So, would we need? More than one query, for instance, to download all the available data of EPOS?
No. If you use the command line client, you can download everything because the download is made directly from the server where the data are hosted to the data center. So with the command line client, there is no problem for that. For the web client, I really don't advise to do that. You have normally a message indicating that you have to download only a limited amount of data because it's because of the technical aspect of downloading data with browsers. It's not for EPOS especially.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, there was a small question by Lyoka Pashova. Lyoka, if you can.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
My question concerns the access to listed in the presentation websites and links to Getaway or others. Are they available all the time? And you partially answered to the previous question concerning the amount of data which we can download it as a batch using a...
All the links we show you, they are all available. You can download the command line client from the web client web page. The web client is available. If you click on the link you send in the chat, it's working. And so everything we show you should be working. So I think it's working. In case you find some bug when you do some requests, either with a web client or the command line client, do not hesitate to send an email to the GNSS-DGW email address.
Okay, thank you. Because I tried now to this Getaway, but it's some postponed response for this.
So I also tried it when you sent your question. It was working, but perhaps everybody is trying at the same time. And perhaps we will realize that we have a problem of access when everybody wants to access it.
Yeah.
And
thank you.
If you may, I just try also when I saw your question, and I just can log in, and it was not on. It was not on my cache. So it has online. Now let me tell you this. All these service web services, we are, as we say, we are optimizing them, but they are all already operational. Now it's just sometimes some tweaks, some improvements. Sometimes they go for maintenance, but for short times only to do maintenance, because we are constantly try to improve them. But all these services that we are showing here are running and operational. Okay, so.
Yeah, maybe
thank you.
There is too many people at the same time. And
so
and we have to check.
Yeah. It's a good test, because actually it doesn't work in my place also now.
Okay, we have two more questions. So the first one is by Gail Janek. You can ask him, you.
Yeah, I'm just I'm preparing some work on reprocessing with Gamit EPOS data, and I'm wondering if there's a simple way to get the number of stations that have data day by day on a given year. So for each day, how many stations have some data, in order to for me to check before I start reprocessing everything, to check that my data set is complete.
The only way to check that is to build your own program with the tools that are available with the command line command, and to check with the different data, with different date for each file, the published date, the reference date, etc. And so you have to build your own program and check this kind of dates, in particular the published one, and do a loop. There is no specific service to do what you ask, but there is all the metadata associated with the file. So
I could build something based on the metadata and see if it matches my data set. Yeah, okay.
So again, I didn't hear.
No, I'm saying what you're suggesting is that I build my own. I build this based on the metadata and compared to the data set I've downloaded, and then submit queries if I see differences between these two things, right?
Yeah, I think it would be the best way, because there is also a station that will not have data for a certain amount of time, and at one moment a lot of the data will appear in the system because it's it's remote station. So I think you probably need to think about the good strategy to check what is arriving, not only yesterday, but also to check in the past months.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, next question is by David Gomez. David?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Please ask.
You are also talking about daily Linux file with your examples. And my question is that we produce also over the Linux file. So all the functionalities of Glass platform are available for this kind of Linux files, for over the Linux files?
For the moment, the early Linux file are still under test. We provide daily Linux file, but we don't provide early Linux file for the moment. But it's planned. on them working also.
For a new version?
Yes.
Okay.
And thanks. The question, your question is very interesting because probably the question of QC is the big question. Will we run the QC on the hourly file or not?
Okay.
Because thanks. It's a lot of metadata and for manager, local nodes, it's a lot of work.
Okay. But
one question. So if you have an idea about that or interest in it, it's something that you can send to the EPOS group.
Yeah, but if we are using a local node for us, we can storage the information from our hourly Linux files. And only the daily Linux files information will go to the Gateway Glass platform.
This is the question.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
If I may also just add one thing, that conceptually is possible to have hourly files inside of Glass. It's just in the moment, it's just a question of optimization. And as Mathilde was mentioning, is also increasing, you know, by 24 times the information, and we have to also deal with that in the optimal way.
Yeah. Okay.
So in the moment we are focusing on providing these daily solutions to optimize all these services, that is in our plans, of course.
But is there any problem if we store the hourly information in our local node?
Not at all. All the data are installed on the local node.
Okay. Because we want to use our local node to store all the information for all the kind of Linux files we produce.
Yeah, I understand the need.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, but for the moment, it's better to use it only for daily. We still have some internal tests to do for hourly.
Okay.
Okay. So concept, we will be working on the 1 hour, but for the now, it's the daily. Okay, I think the rest of the